and welcome to The Art of Being Human. We've been dealing with new research in ways to control diabetes, new types of insulin. I'm going to go on with this from where I left off last week, and this is going to be the artificial pancreas. I'm going to discuss first the development of an artificial pancreas. We all know about people who have artificial hearts that they've experimented with, people who can live with artificial hearts, but no one has successfully developed an artificial pancreas, but it is being worked on. Now, the difficulty with the artificial pancreas is it's not just one unit that you have implanted, like the artificial heart is one unit that's implanted. This would not be just one unit. This would be several units that electronically feed information to each other, and then the decision is made electronically what kind of insulin you need, and you would already have the insulin in your system and it would release it. So this is very, very complicated. You have several devices in your system that would communicate with each other electronically and then automatically release the insulin that you need. Now, the problems with it, it's very, very complicated. You don't have just one unit in you, you have several, and that's very complicated. And the other problem is that what if something goes wrong? One unit has to talk with another unit, which has to talk with another unit, and that's, it makes it very problematic. The blood sugar also changes so quickly that it's hard for a machine by itself to keep up with it. I mean, you could take your blood sugar within seconds and get two different readings. So it does change very rapidly. And there's also the risk of kidney disease, eye disease, nerve damage, heart attacks, and stroke while you're on this equipment. Those could be the side effects of having units in your system that talk with each other. I don't hold out a lot of hope for it, but some people do, and maybe eventually you'll have something that acts like an artificial pancreas, not coming from one unit, but several. I myself would not want to have several units in my body at the same time and depend upon them talking to each other electronically. Here are the hurdles that have to be overcome. The way the insulin works is complicated. The devices used have to be compatible with each other, and they all have to be working perfectly well. The cost would be very high. Would insurance cover it? Probably not. You would have danger of getting residue in the lungs, something I discussed last time. And would you forget to take the insulin if you only had to take it once a week? Supposing that you had to take insulin only once a week, and we've talked about that a little bit last time, and that insulin gets released when it's needed, as determined by these units that have been implanted in your system. Now, we all know about heart pacemakers and things that are implanted in the heart, and they work relatively well, and a lot of people have been saved. My niece, one of my nieces, was born with heart problems, and she had her first open heart surgery at 3 days old, and they did save her. She had a massive hole in her heart. Her heart wasn't developed. They actually repaired her heart and rebuilt part of her heart by using mesh and other materials, and she survived. She's doing well, but every 5 years she has to have a new pacemaker, every 4 or 5 years, and her little body was so tiny they couldn't fit a pacemaker in her chest when she was tiny. So what they did was they put a pacemaker in her abdomen and wired it to her chest so that her body was filled with wires from the pacemaker to the heart, and it worked well. You know, she survived and she's doing pretty well. Now, she's not going to ever be able to play impact sports or anything like that, but she's learning and she's growing and she's doing well. So we know people do well if they have things implanted within them, as long as it's accurate and it's careful. But when you're talking about the pancreas, I mean, the heart's going to beat at a certain pace, but when you're talking about the pancreas, the blood sugar is continually changing. Not only is it continually changing, but you've got several units you have to work with. You have to take the insulin, and the units decide when that insulin gets released. And so if you take enough insulin for a week, those units had better be perfect. I know some doctors have even talked to me about using the insulin pump, and I've refused because I don't trust them completely. I know a lot of people have a lot of good luck with the insulin pumps, and they really love them. But I have a problem. I read about a coach. It was a baseball coach or an umpire. I think it was an umpire. And suddenly he collapsed. He was taken to the hospital in an ambulance, and they discovered that he had an insulin pump, and the insulin pump had malfunctioned and given him too much insulin, and he couldn't feel it. He didn't know he was getting too much insulin, but then he collapsed because he went into a coma because he had too much insulin because the instrument malfunctioned. Now they're pretty much free of defects, and they don't act up every so often, but this was only 2 years ago. So I would rather take my own blood sugar, see what it is, take my insulin, and just have hands-on control of it. I feel safer that way. But a lot of people use pumps, and they do very well with them. So I'm not trying to discourage anybody from using a pump if they want to. When you get to a pancreas, an artificial pancreas, this is something that is so complicated that if it's not perfect, then you could be in real trouble, and that's my problem with it. But I suppose that by the time they would put something like this on the market, it would have been tested and tested and tested. Hopefully it would be all right. But the hurdles to overcome is the fact that devices have got to be compatible, they've got to work perfectly, and you do have the problem of insurance companies. Drug companies are always trying to come up with new drugs and new insulin to help people out, but it's expensive, and a lot of insurance companies are not willing to cover for it. Now, I want to go into colorblindness. Now, colorblindness is not directly related to diabetes. It's something that you're born with, but eye problems are related to diabetes, so I'm interested in what is happening in the field of colorblindness. There is now a new special type of glasses out. They cost about $450. They're very expensive. They look like large sunglasses. People who are colorblind can put them on and see color. 2 out of 3 people I helped, quite a number of people I helped with it, and they are delighted and they are surprised, and it's interesting to see their reactions when they first see color, because without those glasses they can't see color. And as I said, it cost about $450 per pair, and it filters out certain light waves. You realize that color is light waves. It filters certain color light waves out, so red, blue, green, and orange can be seen. And it doesn't work with everybody, but it works with a lot of people. So if you are colorblind, but you have a tendency to be able, you do have the anatomy to be able to see some color, it works on that so that you will be able to see 4 major colors. And it's really worth it. People who have it and who see it, who see color for the first time, are just amazed by it, and they really love it. So there are varying degrees of light that you can see, varying degrees and intensities of color that you can see. And I imagine it's quite individual, that some people see more than others, and they are amazed that they can see it. It doesn't, as I said before, it doesn't work with everybody. Now, there is, in terms of blindness, whatever the reason, they are working on a set of glasses. They're large, they look like goggles, but people who use them are able to see somewhat, even if they are technically blind or going blind or will be blind very shortly. I've seen this done. I've seen it in pictures and on television. These goggles, you put them on and they show what can be seen. It's like a visual spectrum. You can see what's around you. You can see people around you. You can see, you know, so you can walk around your house and not bump into anything. You'd probably be able to take a walk. You wouldn't be able to see a wide range of things. It wouldn't be like a scan of things like we can see with our eyes, our peripheral vision. I mean, I can see my fingers out here, even though they're not in front of my face. So we have all that peripheral vision we can see. They can't can't see that, but they could see what's in front of them, and they could see a certain distance, so it would be very helpful to them, because I think they could even probably watch some television, and they'd be able to walk around their house, and they'd be able to do the dishes, and they'd be able to do some chores, and they could see enough to make life much more easy for them. So you don't see a lot, but you do see enough, clearly enough, so that you can say that you're a visual person. You probably would never be able to drive with them, but at the same time, a little vision, if you are blind, a little vision and seeing even the length of this table and the people in front of me would be like a miracle. If I was blind and I could see that much from glasses, I surely would probably want to be seeing them all the time. From what I saw, it's not great on color, but the fact is you do see. It might be more grayish and black and white, but the fact is you do see. And I'm not sure how many types of blindness would be helped by it, but some people are being helped by it, and it certainly is worth it. I saw a little boy on television. He was on one of these shows, and they talked to him about being blind, and all of a sudden the doctor says, well, we have a surprise for you. And they brought out one of these glasses, this set of glasses that looked like goggles, put them on him, and he was utterly amazed. He could see. For him, that's vision, you know? So I'm hoping they do a lot more research like that, because I'd like to see anyone who's colorblind to be able to see color, because you're missing so much if you don't. And I'd like to see that everybody that has vision problems are likely to see something, a certain amount, so they can have a more full life rather than being in total darkness. It must be terrible to be in total darkness, but I know people who are blind. You can be blind from diabetes. You have to be careful. You have to check your eyes by an ophthalmologist to check to make sure your eyes are all right. It needs to be done on at least a yearly basis so you can see that you're not getting the complications of diabetes. Some people, they don't know they're diabetic until they go blind. Sometimes I knew a woman who was going blind and she couldn't understand it. She went to the doctor and it was determined that she was diabetic and that she'd been diabetic for years, but nobody ever knew it. So she was having complications from the diabetes that was affecting her eyes, and she was going blind. She didn't even know that she was diabetic. Well, they were able to take care of the blood sugar enough so her vision came back. Vision is really important, and I'm really fascinated by it. Now, this I want to talk about a man who was colorblind, and he saw everything in shades of gray. It's not directly related to diabetes, but it's just an interesting thing. And I know I brought this in once before, but I want to review it now. Sound has wavelengths, but color has wavelengths too. And what they were able to do with this man, and there's a lot of research being done overseas, not so much in the United States because it's considered to be too experimental to get money to cover it, but this particular man had a chip put in his head, probably close to his brain. And then he put on a device. I'm going to show you this. The chip is in the head, and then he puts on a device. It's like a strap around his head, and there's a little extension that comes in front of his eyes, and he can hear color. All he has to do is look at a shade of gray, because he is colorblind, and it will emit a tone. And he can hear that tone, so he knows what color it is by the tone that he hears. Now, he's still colorblind. It doesn't give him his color back, but he can hear the tone, and he knows he's looking at red or blue or green or yellow, whatever the color is, because every color has its own tone, and he has gotten to recognize what those tones are. It's to the point where he's able to do paintings. When he does paintings usually they're concentric circles of different colors. I thought I had something here to show you. I think I do somewhere. Here it is. I'm going to hold this up. This would be an example. It's my drawing, but I'm imitating what he does for his paintings. He gets these colors. He looks at he hears the color. He picks the paint. Now, the paint, of course, to him is also gray, so it has to be marked. If he's hearing red, he goes to the paint that's marked red, because he's hearing it, and then he paints with the red, and then he looks at another color, and it may be marked yellow, and he's hearing the tone, so he knows it's yellow, so he goes to the paint marked yellow, and he can do paintings in color based upon what he's hearing from the tones. So he is actually hearing color. We don't often think about that, because we look at color and it's wonderful, and I love color, and I buy things sometimes just because I like the color, and people paint with color, and I don't stop to try, I don't even think about hearing the tones of color. I have heard, though, that some people who are blind and don't see, they can take material, different types of cloth, and they can put their hands on it, and they can tell by the texture what color it is, even though they can't see it. And as long as the texture is clear, they can say, oh, that's a red jacket, or that's a blue shirt. They can actually tell by the texture. But color does emit light, and color does, and if you can hear it, it has wavelengths, and if you can pick up those wavelengths for the color, then you know what the color is, even if you're seeing it as gray. So you get to hear color. And as I said, nobody who has a vision that can see color ever would bother with something like that. Why would they? But those are the research projects that are in effect here. Now I want to talk about neuropathy. Neuropathy is very painful. It's when your fingers and your feet, usually the extremities, they are numb, prickly, don't feel good, painful. I know I used to, before my blood sugar was in better control, I used to drive and I used to get these awful feelings in my feet, and I used to describe it as halfway between an itch and a pain. And it feels like it's going at a very deep level, and it is, because what's happening is that the nerves of the feet or the hands are absorbing the sugar that you have in your bloodstream because your sugar is too high. Well, now there is an experimental shot. Somebody has devised a gene and they can inject it into your leg twice, and they do it 2 weeks apart. Each leg gets two shots, 2 weeks apart. And after 3 months, 48% of the people reported at least 50% relief of pain from neuropathy. There's no side effects, and the pain relief lasts for about 9 months. So if you are a person who's diabetic and you're having a lot of neuropathy pain, and it's not just your fingers and your feet, although that's the most obvious, but when you get into the stomach digestion, gastroparesis, which I mentioned before, that I've talked about before, that's a type of neuropathy in the stomach that affects the digestion. Nerves travel everywhere in your system. They can all be affected by neuropathy, and it gives you different types of symptoms, and it gives you different kinds of conditions. So this gene, if you inject it twice in each leg, a couple of weeks apart, then after a while, a certain amount of period of time, a lot of the pain of neuropathy goes away, and you are a lot more comfortable with no side effects. So I think this is what I have. There's always more. There's just always more that being people experimenting with different things, and you take certain things and it helps you, or certain things you can do to make your life more comfortable. You've got to remember that every disease that's considered to be a chronic disease, as diabetes is, it affects your life. And some people are really disturbed when they find out that they're really diabetic. They're really disturbed by that. They get really upset about that. They go into grief reactions, personality changes, and we're going to go into all of that. Probably the last segment, and I have two or three segments left on diabetes, probably all of them have a grief reaction. It takes at least 6 weeks to understand and get your head wrapped around the fact that you have a chronic disease, and the chronic disease will not leave. You will always have it, barring some kind of a miracle. You will always have it. So next time we meet, I'm going to talk about the things that people have done to get help, and the things that have helped people go through their diabetic journey. Different teas, different herbs, different spices, different kinds of food. What's really helped them keep their diabetes in control? And things that you can do to help your teeth and to help your gums. It's all very interesting and it's all very practical. And I'm not advocating that you use these things, but a lot of people have been helped. So whether you use them is your choice. I just want to bring them to your attention. So we'll be doing that next time. So I'm going to close it here. We're almost out of time anyway, and I'm going to ask you to join me next time to, so you can get rounded out here with what's available for your health. So please join me next time.